Okay, so first of all, thank you all for coming here. My primary goal is to demystify this subject because, you know, it's associated with words like neural and intelligence and so forth. And you see that actually the level of intelligence isn't that high, and it has very little to do with the neurons that we have in your brain. And I'll tell you a story. You know, I was going to the USA to give a talk, and the immigration officer asked me, what are you going to talk about? So I said, I'm going to talk about neural networks, and I thought I should explain a bit more. So I said, it works a little bit like the brain. So he said to me, you know, I wish my boss had a neural network. Simply because we use these words, I think it's very, very far away from what you would consider as intelligence or even the word neural is emotive. Okay, so this is what a typical materials science department does. It covers all of these subjects, okay? Device materials, physical metallurgy, chemistry, biomaterials, polymers, etc. And it's the most interdisciplinary science subject that you can get. And all of these subjects have two things in common. First of all, characterization at all levels, going from atoms all the way to engineering structures. And the second thing that is now common in all material departments is that there is some sort of mathematical modeling. And the reason for this is very simple, that it's no longer acceptable to spend 20 years developing a material. Now, it just takes too long to put into service if you do that. Typical timescales are between 3 and 5 years to do this. And just like Microsoft, mathematical models are basically tools. They're too simple to actually solve the problems that you need to address, but they help lubricate the way towards a quick solution. So they reduce the number of resources that you require. Same applies to electron microscopes, atom probes, etc. They only help you to reach a goal. And similarly, all the mathematical models are frankly too simple to deal with real materials. And these are all the sort of techniques that are available to help develop materials. So you have first principles calculations in which you can handle a cluster of atoms and decide, okay, if I want to create iron in the diamond crystal structure, what sort of energy gap would that be relative to iron on Earth? Molecular dynamics, a little bit more empirical, and you can include large numbers of atoms. Thermodynamics, huge, massive numbers of atoms. But again, it's basically an empirical subject. Irreversible thermodynamics is between kinetics and thermodynamics. It makes the assumption that forces and fluxes are linearly related. And then you have kinetics, which is the most difficult subject because there's always two fitting parameters in it, which is the interfacial energy and the number density of nucleation sites. And then you have engineering tools like finite element analysis and so forth. And the entire goal is to relate structure and properties. Okay? Structure at all scales and properties at all scales. But the major thing that has been missing for some time is how to estimate uncertainties in the predictions that you make. And I will go into this in a little bit more detail. But you never give an answer that I will design a material that has a strength of 1,000 megapascals. You need to actually specify a range of uncertainty, and hopefully you hit the right region in that range. And this is now a subject which is taught to undergraduates. Okay, so this is a book that we put together on materials modeling, quite a thin, readable book, which covers all of these topics. So it's no longer a fancy subject. Materials modeling is permeates everything in the materials department. Okay, now, you know, in Oxford and Cambridge, we have colleges and we work in interdisciplinary environments by definition. You know, in the college, we have all subjects covered. And there are certain subjects which use phrases which become very popular. And one of those phrases is that there is a theory of everything. So, you know, if I ask Stephen Hawking to calculate any of these properties, he would not be able to do that. Okay. Actually, nobody in the whole world would be able to calculate any of these properties. So this is the ability of material to absorb energy on impact. You're traveling in a car and you have an accident, you really want the car to absorb the energy rather than yourself, right? So this is the most important property, these two, the Charpy energy and the critical stress intensity, for a safe engineering material. And you might have heard that graphene is 200 times stronger than steel, but actually it's not. It's a useless structural material, and its toughness is next to zero because when you break it, all the energy is released elastically, which is not what you want. You want it to absorb the energy. Then even corrosion, nobody can predict corrosion rates. Fatigue is the biggest cause of failure in structural materials, and the Humble tensile test, nobody can predict any of these properties. So when you hear phrases like theory of everything, it's really nonsense. We need to find methods of dealing with complexity, otherwise we cannot actually predict new materials. Okay, just to emphasize the difficulties, this is a bearing. In your typical house, you'll have about 300 of these objects, and basically they reduce friction. Okay, so you have balls in there and two rings and a shaft going through the center and something rotating, and therefore it's a lubricated object and you would have almost frictionless running. Okay, and just to give you an idea, the pressure that is experienced, so I don't know if this is working very well, but the pressure experienced here under the surface is of the order of 2 gigapascals. So that's the weight of 2 billion apples on 1 square meter. Okay? And this might be going round at a certain revolution per minute. And let's assume the number of balls is 20, then there would be about 500,000 pulses of 2 gigapascals experienced at any point on that ring in 1 minute. Right? Now imagine that somebody was punching you on the face 500,000 times per minute with that sort of contact pressure. So you see, these materials are tolerating huge amounts of pain. And they are just wonderful things. But just to tell you, the parameters involved in the design of a material for this, very large number of parameters, okay? Not just about the material, but whether you can actually make it. Can't make it, then it's not of practical use. Maybe interesting, but it's not of practical use. So it's very, very difficult to design a material. And if you hear in the news that someone has made something very, very strong, that is of no use at all to an engineer. You need a whole basket of parameters to define the material. Okay? So I read an interview with Branson, saying, you know, aircraft are going to be made out of graphene in the future. 10 years' time is his prediction, okay? Let's watch this page. Right, so the problem is that properties we can measure. We have all kinds of instrumentation to measure these properties. And the properties measured can be used to make sure that your design is safe. That is, it's going to last for a certain period of time after which you replace a component, and that it's not going to fail catastrophically and lead to a loss of life. And of course, measurements can also be used in control. But if I gave you a comprehensive description of the material, okay, and everything you need to know about the material, you would not be able to predict those properties. Okay? So, you know, the level of complexity is too high. So one big advantage is that, you know, science has been going on for a very long time, and now there are more scientists in existence than ever existed, and we have lots and lots of money for instruments and so forth. So we have huge quantities of data, and exists in the literature and in data banks and so on, and nowadays we are required to put all of our experimental data online so that everybody else can access it. So there's vast quantities of data on all these complex properties, and we can exploit those data in the way that I'm going to illustrate. So this is a steam turbine, And this is Tracy Cool, with about 1.2 meters high. And you can see the size of that steam turbine, right? And that steam turbine has to operate for 40 years with steam temperatures of the order of 600 degrees centigrade and stresses of the order of 100 megapascals without failure. And a typical composition of the material out of which that is made will have a large number of alloying additions. So the ordinary steel that you see will have about 20 different additions of elements to achieve the particular properties that you need. So when you see a lump of steel, it's not the same as another lump of steel. It's been carefully controlled in its chemical composition, often to parts per million, even though you're manufacturing, you know, 1.6 billion tons of the material every year. Okay. So if you went to a steel plant, you know, you'd be amazed. It's like a giant robot, you know? Hardly see any people on the production line. And then there are the processing of steel. You need to join up components, and so on and so on. So we were asked, you know, to design a steel in which you can raise the steam temperature to 650 degrees centigrade, because thermodynamics tells you that the higher the highest temperature in the operating cycle, the greater the efficiency. Now, an ordinary approach to this would be to simplify the problem. Reduce the number of variables. And I want to show you what happens when you do that. So this is the normal scientific method. Let's say we have some variables, X and Y. And we've got a set of data there. It looks pretty random, doesn't it? As if there's no relationship there. And that's because there are two variables that I have ignored. One is the Z-axis, and the other is the time. As soon as I put those variables in, it will become absolutely obvious what this is, right? So there's a danger in simplifying technological problems, right? By making the number of variables smaller and smaller until you can do some science is not the way forward. We need to take account of all these variables. So the method that you choose has to be able to take account of large numbers of variables, because those are the variables that influence properties. So the solution is, in hindsight, simple. That it's not going to be linear. You know, even though scientists like to use linear functions, there's going to be complexity. We need to deal with large numbers of variables and definitely have a good understanding of the uncertainties that go with this, and exploit the very large quantities of data that exist. You learn from your data. Okay, so the way you might start off, say if you're modeling strength, is write a linear regression equation where, you know, you say, okay, the strength is going to vary as a function of the carbon concentration, the manganese concentration, and the nickel concentration. Then, you know, you go and see your supervisor, who says, look, I know from physics that carbon and manganese don't act independently. So you go and you create another term like that. Okay. It's fairly arbitrary, isn't it? You multiply carbon by manganese. And then, you know, one day you have a bad dream. So you write So the problem with ordinary regression analysis is that, you know, we are only doing it because we don't understand the science, right? And therefore, we don't know what relationship to use. So we need to have a method which actually discovers the relationship. I'm going to show you how that works. And I'll start by still focusing on the linear regression problem. So here you have the three inputs, carbon, the strength, and the phosphorus content. We want to predict the ability of the material to absorb energy. So what I do is I multiply carbon by a random number, which is the WC, a weight, multiply the strength by a random number, phosphorus by a random number, and then I do some addition in the middle, so that's called a hidden unit. We only see the input and the output, and we predict a value of toughness which will not be correct because we've chosen random numbers, right? But then I have an experimental value of toughness. So I compare and I modify the weights until I get some sort of closure. So that's a neural network representation of a linear regression equation. You have the input nodes, the output nodes, and in the middle you've done some mathematical operation to find a value of toughness, and then you've propagated it backwards to modify the coefficients. So I think everybody understands this method. We need to make it nonlinear. So instead of just adding up those terms in the middle, we need to multiply it by some function which is very flexible. And this brings me back to the bad dream, because hyperbolic tangents are very nice functions which can be extremely flexible depending on the coefficients. So if you look at one on the on your left, you know, by varying the coefficients, there are regions where it's almost linear, where it's gently changing, and then more steeply changing. And you're not limited to using one hyperbolic tangent. You could have two hyperbolic tangents which have different weights, and then you get a further degree of nonlinearity. So on a neural network, you would represent that as follows, that instead of doing just one set of operations on each input, you have two sets of operations, so that you get a more flexible function to fit your data. So this is with two hidden units, and you're not limited to the number of hidden units that you put in the middle. But you know, I'm showing some problems and you increase the complexity of the model. People often say that neural networks are black boxes, but actually they are completely explicit mathematical functions and very, very simple to write down. So this is precisely the representation of any complexity of neural network. You have y, which is what you're trying to predict. You have the x, which are the inputs, and then a variety of hidden units, h, over there, adding up all these hyperbolic tangent functions, and theta is like the constant that you have in a regression equation. Okay? So it's completely explicit. It might, you know, if I put in all the values of weights and I have 100 input variables, then it's going to be a very long equation. But that's not a problem. You know? But you repeat the calculation, you get exactly the same answer. It's a very explicit mathematical function. So that kind of demystifies this at this stage. There's nothing really difficult about neural networks. Now, just to illustrate to you that by adding up all these functions, I can get a very flexible function. Here is a movie showing you just four hyperbolic tangent functions and two variables, and you can see that by changing the weights, I can make this function sing and dance, right? Extremely flexible, which means that, you know, you capture the complexity in your data. And this is just four hidden units. Now, here's a question for you, just to see if you're awake. I've got a set of experimental points. Which function should I use? Should I use the straight line or the squiggly one? Okay, but how do you know that? Yeah, I mean, we've got uncertainty on the data. Could well be the polynomial, right?
When this thing goes to infinity?
Maybe it should go to infinity. At this stage, we don't know. Okay, we cannot actually say which function is correct. We are uncomfortable with using the polynomial because we're trained with it like that, but it could well be the correct function. So what you do is you have data, okay, and you split it up like this. You use one set of data for training the model, and the other one for testing how it behaves on unseen data. So here you are. The black dots are the training data, and the open circles are the test data. Now, the linear curve is too simple to capture the complexity in the data, and you will have a large training error and a large test error. Okay? a very simple model on the complexity scale is towards the towards your left. The model C does not properly represent unseen data, so it doesn't generalize well. So it's too complicated, you know. So that was the original perception of the polynomial. And in the middle, there's a model which gives you a minimum in the test error. That means the error in the unseen data. So you then fix your complexity at that point, you know, the number of hyperbolic tensions, and you retrain the model on the whole set of data. So you're not wasting any data, but you've chosen the right complexity of model. So what we've done is we've discovered the function that should represent the data. And that is a major advantage of neural networks. Everyone happy with that? Okay. Right, so I have a sequence of numbers, the second question. What will be the next two? What do you think?
10 and 12.
10 and 12, absolutely right. So the next two numbers are 10 and 12. But you know, just as likely is 8.91 and 7.64. The function is the one at the bottom. And if I put, you know, 2 into that, it will be exactly 4. If I put 4, it will be exactly 6. 6 will give me exactly 8. But 8 will give me 8.91. So these two functions precisely represent the known data. Precisely represent the known data. So within the first 3 points, there is no way that I can distinguish between these two. Absolutely no way. But if I extrapolate, the two functions are giving me different answers. And that is another kind of an error. Okay? And this is something that I learned from David Mackay. You might know of him. He's written this fantastic book on information theory. This is a modeling uncertainty. That means within the range of known data, both of these models are perfectly correct. Okay? But when you generalize, they behave differently. So how do we deal with it? Well, we don't panic. We say, okay, I'm making a prediction outside of the knowledge base, and the models are behaving differently, so I need to be careful about this prediction. There's an error bar, which is not the sort of error bar you normally associate with experiments where if you repeat an experiment, you get a different answer because something is not controlled. This is modeling uncertainty. There are models which behave differently outside of the well-behaved regime. And you can see that as we go further away, the uncertainty becomes larger. So this is a natural way of warning you that you're doing something which you need to think about. Right? Both of the models could be correct, and you need to worry about this. It gives you automatically an indication that there is uncertainty in the model. And it's nothing to do with the noise in the data. Here's another example. You can see in the middle, you know, the three models which adequately represent the experimental data, all of them, they behave differently. So if you take the standard deviation of all those three models, then it gives you a modeling uncertainty. Now it doesn't mean that your prediction is going to be wrong, but you need to worry about it. And remember that we are not interested in doing experiments in the region where all three models behave well. Yeah. That means that the experiment has already been done. And this is a beautiful way of finding out where you need to do experiments. I'll give you examples later. Because you know, when you have 100 variables, it's difficult to see where to do experiments where knowledge is actually missing. This gives you directly an indication that there isn't information there. So you can design your experiments. Now, this is an incredibly complicated process of joining two pieces of steel. So it's called a weld, where you have a gap and you pour liquid metal in there, and it solidifies and forms a joint. And every aspect of physics comes into it, all the way from plasma to, you know, stresses and strains and so forth. So it's a very complicated process. And all engineering structures rely on this. And I told you that, you know, this modeling uncertainty is really important. And we want to work in a regime where that modeling uncertainty is large, because that means we are doing something new. Now, it doesn't mean that your modeling is incorrect. You get a very large modeling answer. It just means that you have to be careful. So we were designing quite complicated welding alloys, and some of these things serve at high temperatures for a very long time. So they're under stress, they get longer and longer and longer. That's called creep. And what that means is that you have to take it out of service after time. Hopefully that is after 40 years. So you can't sit around and do experiments for 40 years. PhD thesis lasts for 3 years, right? So, but you know, if you try to accelerate the test by increasing the stress, that's not representative, because things change inside the material when you apply very high stresses. So we collected vast quantities of creep rupture data, applied the neural network, and we predicted three different kinds of welding alloys. And you see that the modeling uncertainty is very large. The dashed lines give you the modeling uncertainty. But when the experiments were done, they actually worked very well when you compare against the prediction. And the reason for that is that when you choose your inputs, you need to make the inputs physically meaningful. Okay? So it isn't just a mathematical method, but how you design the model that's important, because it will extrapolate nicely if you have put in as much physics as you can in the inputs. So for example, if you are using temperature, it doesn't really make sense to put temperature as a variable, but you might put exponential of minus one upon T, because you know thermal activation works like that, and so on. So you need to choose your variables carefully, and it's incredible. You know, look at this, look at the modeling uncertainty, and yet the predictions are pretty good. And I have a student here, well, he's finished and he's been working in Cullum for years now, and his PhD thesis was that, you know, with the fusion reactor, the level of neutron damage is very high, you know, over the lifetime of a component. It would be 200 displacements per atom. That means every atom will be knocked out of its position 200 times during the lifetime of the object. Impressive, right? Every atom will be knocked out of its position 200 times during the lifetime of the object. Now, there is no facility in the world to give that level of damage at the moment, because in a fission, in a normal reactor, it's about 20 to 30 displacements per atom. But there's no facility in the world to do this. Facilities are being constructed, but the amount of volume that you have to expose test specimens will be very small. So the task was to design experiments which are essential, right? Not experiments which for which we already have knowledge. And the only data we have is from fission reactors, normal reactors. So what he did was, you know, he collected the data, and you know, we discovered that the data have huge numbers of missing variables. So, you know, if you talk to any person who works on steels, you know that you can change the properties of a steel by heat treatment by orders of magnitude, right? But none of the data include information about heat treatment. But you have no choice. These are the data you have. And what that we mean is that the uncertainties go up in the predictions. So he did a lot of work, and you know, this is plotting how the strength increases as neutrons damage the material. Of course, if strength increases, then the ability of the material to absorb energy decreases, and that means it becomes unsafe as a function of time. But I want to show you the next slide, which actually shows you the uncertainties in the predictions. So you would not do experiments in a limited volume of material where we have very low uncertainties. You focus all the experiments in the region where the uncertainties are very large. So this thesis was published some years ago, and you know, I explained to him that we might take it away if the predictions are not correct when the experiments are done. This is just to show you the scale of a steam turbine, and we want to go to steam temperatures which are 700 degrees centigrade, and there is no steel which can survive that temperature over a period of 40 years and the stresses that we want to impose. But we know that in an aircraft engine, the temperature that the blades experience is of the order of 1400 degrees centigrade, and sometimes higher than the melting temperature. Right? So there's a system to protect the blade from exposure to temperatures higher than the melting temperature. You may not want to fly in an aircraft again. I'm telling you stories about it. The absolutely fantastic technology that goes into this. And it's based on nickel alloys, right? So this is a single crystal of nickel alloy, which is amazingly strong even at high temperatures. Now, the trouble with nickel is that it's very expensive. You know, so the aircraft engine is really tiny compared with the steam turbine that I showed you earlier. It's massive. These aircraft engines are large, but they are really quite small compared with power generation turbines. So the cost of a blade like this is its weight in silver. There's no way you can make a power station out of something as expensive as that. So we were tasked with designing a nickel alloy, which would be very, very cheap. So it's not going to operate at 1400, but at 700 degrees centigrade. So we want to reverse engineer, remove all the, you know, ruthenium and all the things that we add to aircraft engine alloy. Patrick knows about this. Greatly reduce the cost. So we designed an alloy, and using neural networks. Again, the alloy is called FT750DC. FT is for Frank Tonkray, the postdoc who did the work. 750 is for the steam temperature, and DC is for dirt cheap. you can tolerate iron in this because if you use scrap material, then it's actually much cheaper. And of course it takes a number of years to do the experiments, but the structure is like this. You know, it's very similar to that in an aircraft engine, but in the aircraft engine alloys you have very large fraction of precipitates, particles. Almost 70% of the space is occupied by these particles, which strengthen it. Here we don't need, you know, we are going to operate at 750, so we have something like 20% of these precipitates. And I'll show you the results. The predictions were made first, and the results obtained later. So these are the strength data. You can see the neural network captured the behavior very well as a function of temperature. And this is the most important set of data, which what we call, you know, if you expose it at temperature with a stress, eventually it will grow longer and break, and that's called rupture, creep rupture. And what we want is that horizontal line. That means after 100,000 hours, you know, it shouldn't break with a stress lower than 100 megapascals. So these experiments take a long time, but nevertheless, the model predictions are pretty good. Now I'm going to show you something even more remarkable. Yeah, I explained to you that, you know, fatigue is the biggest cause of failure of engineering structures. And basically it means that if you apply repeated stresses, very small repeated stresses, well below the stress required to normally break the material, then cracks will grow slowly. And eventually that crack becomes large enough for the whole thing to fall apart. And we collected a large amount of data, published data, on fatigue crack growth in steels, and we decided that we're not going to use the chemical composition of the steel or the heat treatment, because these are mechanical parameters which depend on the chemical composition and the heat treatment. And we created a neural network model for this. And all the graphs that I'm going to show you are predictions on unseen data.
Right.
So yes, it behaves very well. At the bottom is the sort of amplitude by which we cycle the stress, and at the vertical axis is the crack growth rate per cycle. And you can see that there's good agreement between the data and the predictions, and we have those uncertainties. However, if I go back to this slide, There's nothing in here to identify the material as a steel, right? So this should work for other materials as well. So let me show you. So all the data were from steels. Look, nickel alloys, pretty good predictions, okay? There were no nickel alloys whatsoever in the database. There should be, I've got similar slides somewhere on titanium alloys and aluminum alloys. So if you design your model properly, properly meaning that you can generalize to other materials, there's no reason why you can't use it for all metallic materials. And this is now used for aluminum, titanium, nickel, steel. Even though the entire training process was only on steels. So that I find exciting. Now, in making a welding material, again, you have to look at a very large number of variables. Welding is the most complicated process you can have because, you know, when we make normal materials, we process them very carefully and so on. But when we deposit a weld, it puts heat locally, okay? And it damages the region surrounding it, and there's no processing afterwards. And that means you're stuck with the material that you've deposited. So it's quite a difficult technology, very difficult technology. There's a whole welding institute in Cambridge, which has been there for, it's the original spin-out from the University of Cambridge some 60, 70 years ago, still going strong with a vast number of people trying to assure that there's structural integrity. So we were designing a welding material for a power plant, and you can see that it's not actually an easy task. So we used neural networks again, and this is the typical sort of electrode that you have. We can make any kind of alloy by taking basically an ordinary piece of steel and covering it with alloying elements, because they are all going to melt when you strike an arc. So it's a very easy process to make many different kinds of alloys if you wish. And we made some predictions and we achieved the strength properties and elongation and toughness. But you can see from this that things are not completely as they should be. You know, as we went to higher and higher test temperatures, you can see that we are getting big discrepancies between the neural network prediction and the actual experiments. 700 degrees C, you know, is well outside of the uncertainty. So that's what we call an outlier. Now, why is that? So let me do a very simple experiment to see what's happening. Now, these are the ones where everything behaves itself, and this is the structure that we expect. But for the 700 degrees C experiment, something very strange was happening. We call this recrystallization. So some parts of the material were growing new crystals, and that weakens the material. Now, from the metallurgy we know how to control this. We simply add a certain element which will pin the boundaries and stop recrystallization. Problem solved. Yeah. So even when you have a disagreement, you know, it's very interesting. It gives you the way forward to sort out that problem. And these are the commercial electrodes. Okay. The reel is for continuous welding, and the sticks are for when you make small welds. Okay, so this slide was misplaced. This is the fatigue prediction for titanium and aluminum alloys. And you can see it's pretty good agreement. Now, to do these experiments is quite expensive. So if you can make predictions, it's very good. Now, there is a general problem with research on neural networks, right? And I'll explain this. You know, the basis of any scientific publication is that it should be reproducible, right? You know, if somebody else cannot reproduce it, then you cannot ever have confidence in that method. So I've set up a marking scheme. So you just get one mark for actually creating the model. And then you make some predictions with the model. That it's always good to test whether the model generalizes. And you investigate experimentally, and you are accumulating more and more points. And you've taken care of treating uncertainties properly, both the noise in experimental data and the modeling uncertainty. And the most important thing is that you should disseminate the model and the data. If you don't, nobody else can check your work or even do a better model. So it's really good practice, and it's not science if you don't do this. Don't give your data away and your model away. Now, you know, people in industry will argue against that, but certainly if you do the work in universities, you should make all this available so that other people can develop from there. Right, so I've given you a few examples to illustrate the method and to demystify it, and there's a lot more information on that website. Furthermore, you know, if you look at that 1999 review, you see that the method is applied to a vast range of materials across all the disciplines. And there is nothing black box about it. It's a pure mathematical function that you can interrogate as you wish. Okay? So I will end there, and I'll be happy to answer questions.
What would be your suggestions to set up the neural network in a way to have inputs that are at the same time exhaustive but also exclusive?
Right.
Because quite often with complex materials, different inputs influence each other.
Right.
And then the second question would be also, how can we make sure that after we've run the neural network and we get our results, we don't just get results about things that we already knew about our materials, because looking at a lot of papers, in the conclusions, these are things that have been known for 50 years. There was, to be honest, no need to do the study.
Correct. Yeah. So the first question was, you know, how do you choose the inputs, and how do you choose them so that, you know, they're physically meaningful, right? Now, the interactions between inputs is actually the huge advantage of neural networks. You know, all the curves that I showed, if I change some of the variables, they will show a different trend. So that is important, because that is how physics tells you things should happen. That, you know, if I change one variable, then the other influence of the other variable will change. So that's captured in the neural network. But the way in which you pick the inputs, that has to rely on your knowledge about the material. Not much you can do using the neural network to actually select the inputs. The problem is that if you try to be exhaustive, you may not actually have enough data, and your modeling uncertainty will be very large. So you don't need to specify the number of data that you need before you do this. All that will happen is that you get a very large uncertainty. So sometimes you have to compromise and say, in order to increase the data, I will need to leave out some elements. And from my knowledge, I think the least risk would be with these particular variables. Just remind me of the second one.
I guess in general, how to set up the studies to actually learn something new about the materials.
Absolutely.
Because that's my feeling, that quite often, even if you get, let's say, some useful information on how to design new materials, you maybe haven't actually understood the fundamental processes behind it.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. And I think the thing to do is always to look in the regions where the uncertainty is large, because that definitely indicates that we do not know. The data don't represent that region. And then to do an experiment.
Can we take that idea one step further and have that happening almost in real time, so that you make a measurement in an area? uncertainty, you've only got 5 days of meeting time, can you use these techniques to actually automatically tell you which experiment should be done next?
I think so. The only issue, and that may no longer be an issue, is that the training of the network, depending on the size of your problem, takes quite a long time. Once it is trained, it's milliseconds to run, but the training can be very time-consuming. May not be a problem, depending on the scale of what you're doing, because computers are, you know, faster and faster. Somebody had?
So this is like a very interesting method, but it seems to me that that there are a lot of other kind of machine learning techniques you could apply instead of neural networks, so like Gaussian processes or other like Bayesian non-parametrics. Do you have a...
Yeah, I mean, Gaussian processes is just a generalization of the neural network, so that means you have an infinite number of hidden units, basically.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you can view it like... I mean, like, all these things are kind of like universal function approximators, so like in some sense they're all like either more general or more specific forms, but do you know why you chose, or like is there a rationale behind neural networks in particular as like the training mechanism versus like a sport vector machine or something of another form?
No, I think you're absolutely right that there are many methods. Trouble is, I'm not an expert on machine learning. The sort of thing that Google DeepMind is doing is somewhat different from what I've explained. You know, it even plays games against itself. You know,
right.
to create data to learn. So there is there was a conference held recently in honor of David McCarr, and all the different methods were presented, and they are on the YouTube channel that you'll find on that website.
Other ways are there of making use of prior knowledge? You've already talked about the choice of variables that you're going to put in. But you may not also know an awful lot about the mechanisms from your prior knowledge of ontology in the various different disciplines. What ways are there of optimizing how the machine learning makes use of those in converging on the most accurate solution as quickly as possible?
And beyond what I've said, the answer is I don't know, to be honest. Yeah, and perhaps a machine learning person might be able to answer that better. I mean, there is this, I talked about missing variables. If you make your variable set too comprehensive, you won't have the data. And there are these things called fuzzy methods, which can handle that, but I don't understand them myself.